ebers.com.
Muhammad Rasulullah alayhi salatullah.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. أما بعد، today is Sunday the 13th of August 2006. Welcome once again as we go through the tafsir of Surah Yusuf and derive from it the various lessons that it has to offer us. It is a school of lessons, and it only has benefit for us. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant us the understanding. Once again, just before continuing, we have a question here. I am currently involved in pacifying depressed people. Can the Shaykh please advise what Islam teaches? I'm gathering that the question is asking about lessons from Islam in regards to depression. Now, obviously, I will answer the question, because Islam does teach us about depression, and one of the subjects that I have to do, or that is taught at the Islamic University there in Riyadh, is psychology. So with that, I will try and tackle the problem. Obviously, we only answer on that which we know. And this is also a lesson that the ulama teach us, that you only answer on that which you know. Never ever attempt to answer that which you don't know. In fact, the ulama have said that saying no is half of ilm. When you don't know something, you say you don't know, because by trying to answer something that you don't know, you'll only cause some more misguidance. I'm gathering from the questioner that she wants me to actually discuss about depression. Now, obviously, depression, as I was taught when doing the psychology subject there in Riyadh, they taught us then that depression is not a normal aspect of being sad. It's actually a more severe case of one actually being sad. So one can say it is actually intense sadness. Now, we find especially today that this is a widespread mental illness, and we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala his protection. It seems that, and this is the reason why also we're going through Surah Yusuf, trying to optimize the Muslim Ummah and its lessons for us in patience, that no matter what test we go through, you know, people become depressed for so many reasons. Two reasons that come to mind are obviously, one, an external cause, and secondly, an internal cause. From the external causes, meaning obviously we're talking about factors that affect the outside of a person, such as the likes of losing a loved one, or somebody may lose some money, some social standing, you know, somebody's investment went bad. These are causes, or external causes, causes for one to actually become depressed and become sad. So it's not a normal level of sadness, it is an intense level of one being sad. And internal causes have to do obviously with one's physical makeup, such as the brain cells. I was taught also that it's an aspect of the thyroid hormones, if I remember correctly, has a part to play in one actually being depressed, or the body actually lacking certain vitamins. Now, there are many remedies offered to us by the medical personnel, and first and foremost Islam, in regards to treating depression. First and foremost, in regards to the Quran talking about depression, an ayah just comes to mind in Surah Mujadala, whereby Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, "Inna man najwa min ash-shaytan liyahzuna alladhina amanu," that the secrets or the whispers of shaitan are only to create grief and anxiety and sadness amongst those who believe. So the conspiracies of shaitan are so that he may cause grief and anxieties to the believers. So this is taught to us from the Quran, the aspect of this intense level of sadness, better known as depression. So as depression is a mental illness, obviously the treatment for it is by means, as I said, first from the Holy Quran, especially in the cases where the causes are external. The patient should obviously be, or the person suffering this depression, obviously first and foremost, he or she should be reminded of that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he is the controller, he is the sustainer, he is the one who holds every aspect of qadr and taqdeer. It's he who decides what happens and what doesn't happen. We need to be obliging, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will test you. I've mentioned it in the tafsir many a time and in many a lecture before, that if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves you, he's going to test you. So if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tests you, it's because he loves you. You have to be patient on it, and you have to understand the aspect of taqdeer, and this is from the elements of one's iman. The stronger the iman, the better the understanding. So al-qada wal-qadr, this is something which a believer needs to do justice to when it comes to its understanding and believing in it. It's no point saying that we believe in all that, or we believe that all good and bad is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and then when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tests us, we start questioning Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is from the evils of one actually being depressed, where you live in a circumstance and state where you have actually lost hope. Now, examples, obviously, we can take from the Sahaba radiallahu anhum ajma'een in the manner of actually dealing with depression, obviously in the different du'as and the different adhkar, remembrances taught to us by Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. One that comes to mind is a narration that we find, this is an authentic hadith narrated by Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu, where Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, he taught us that at the times of distress, at the time when we actually affected by this calamity, by this depression, by this sadness, by this intense sadness, we should say, La ilaha illallahu al-azim al-halim, La ilaha illallahu rabbul arsh al-kareem, La ilaha illallahu rabbul samawati wal-ardi rabbul arsh al-kareem. So this is a dua taught to us by Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, helping us deal with the depression. Obviously, we're speaking from the aspect of the Quran and the Sunnah. There's obviously other, or the medical practitioners will recommend for you different medication, etc. But we're talking first as a believer, and that which is taught to us by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in regards to you, O Muslim, when you do find yourselves suffering an intense sadness. So we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make it easy from us. Other adhkar, obviously, we can say Subhanallah al-Azim, glory be to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who is the Almighty, or we can say Ya Hayyu Ya Qayyum bi rahmatika. Obviously, we're seeking, or we see Ya Hayyu Ya Qayyum, meaning the ever living one. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is ever living, and Al Qayyum, He's everlasting. And we say, Bi rahmatika astaghith, that Ya Allah, by your mercy, we seek your assistance. So we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to protect us from the evils of one becoming depressed. This is not a praiseworthy state, obviously, and the Muslim ummah needs to exercise patience. And obviously, as we said, depression is caused by internal and external causes. When it's external, in regards to one actually losing family or losing wealth and losing these things, we need to be patient and understand that whatever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does, He does good. There's no need for us to start questioning, why did this happen to me, etc. This is from the weakness of one's iman. And if it's an internal aspect, obviously we can seek medical assistance, like we did mention, one actually lacking their vitamins or those other things taught to us by the people who deal with psychology and the mind and the body in regards to one's in regards to one actually being depressed. So we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to protect us from that. Yesterday we ended the tafsir speaking about the Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam actually in the prison, and we mentioned that he went from test to test to test, subhanallah, and he passed every test with flying colors. Then we mentioned him in the prison, and we said that in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's revelation, in every word that he has used, there is a lesson for us. And obviously we did say that this tafsir, we have left so much out because we don't have the time, and we mentioned so many reasons at the beginning of the tafsir. We've left so much out, but in every word that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has said, there is a lesson from us. Today we will go through him in the prison and the way he portrayed himself and conducted himself and the different things that he actually did. And this today, respected elders and brothers, my dear mothers and sisters, is a lesson for all those on how to conduct themselves, a lesson for all those who are specialized in the field of inviting towards good and preventing from evil, how to carry out this important job responsibility properly. Now, before we continue, we listen to the recitation, inshallah.
A'udhu billahi min ash-shaytan ar-rajim.
ودخل معه السجن فتيان قال أحدهما إني أراني أعصر خمرا وقال الآخر إني أراني أحمل فوق رأسي خبزا تأكل الطير منه نبئنا بتأويله إنا نراك من المحسنين قال لا يأتيكما طعام ترزقانه إلا نبأتكما بتأويله قبل أن يأتيكما ذلكما مما علمني ربي إني تركت ملة قوم لا يؤمنون بالله وهم بالآخرة هم كافرون واتبعت ملة آبائي إبراهيم وإسحاق ويعقوب ما كان لنا أن تشرك بالله من شيء ذلك من فضل الله علينا وعلى الناس ولكن أكثر الناس لا يشكرون يا صاحبي السجن أأرباب متفرقون خير أم الله الواحد القهار يا صاحبي السجن أأرباب متفرقون خير أم الله الواحد القهار ما تعبدون من دونه إلا أسماء سميتموها أنتم وآباؤكم ما أنزل الله بها من سلطان إن الحكم إلا لله أمر ألا تعبدوا إلا إياه ذلك الدين القيم ولكن أكثر الناس لا يعلمون يا صاحبي السجن أما أحدكما فيسقي ربه خمرا وأما الآخر فيصلب فتأكل الطير من رأسه قضي الأمر الذي فيه تستفتيان وقال للذي ظن أنه ناج منهما اذكرني عند ربك فأنساه الشيطان ذكر ربه فلبث في السجن بضع سنين وقال الملك إني أرى سبع بقرات سمان يأكلهن سبع عجاف وسبع سنبلات خضر وأخر يابسات يا أيها الملأ أفتوني في رؤياي إن كنتم للرؤيا تعبرون قالوا أضغاث أحلام وما نحن بتأويل الأحلام بعالمين وقال الذي نجا منهما وادكر بعد أمة أنا أنبئكم بتأويله فأرسلون يوسف أيها الصديق أفتنا في سبع بقرات سمان يأكلهن سبع عجاف وسبع سنبلات خضر وأخر يابسات لعلي أرجع إلى الناس لعلهم يعلمون قال تزرعون سبع سنين دابا فما حصدتم فذروه في سنبله إلا قليلا مما تأكلون ثم يأتي من بعد ذلك سبع شداد يأكلن ما قدمتم لهن إلا قليلا إلا قليلا مما تحصنون ثم يأتي من بعد ذلك عام فيه يغاث الناس وفيه يعصرون
Just before continuing with the tafsir, you know, just listening to these beautiful ayat of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the question that was asked to me just now in regards to depression, and that we have taken lesson upon lesson in the tafsir of Surah Yusuf, meaning looking at the test that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave him and that he had every reason to become depressed and suffer this intense sadness. I mean, he's a young boy and we've discussed the different trials and tribulations that he has gone through and how he dealt with himself and making sure that he didn't fall into the avenue of anxiety and depression. And if we just think about it, I was just thinking about it as the ayat were going through, you know, as a remedy for somebody who's actually feeling sad or suffering from intense sadness, we should remember what Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam remembered, the aspect of tawheed. He put his trust totally in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. By doing that, there's no a reason for one to actually become depressed, or it will actually help the person who is in a state of intense sadness. It will assist them in coming out of them. Obviously, one should, like how Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam, declaring that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is above everything. It was better for him to suffer the way he suffered as long as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was happy with him. And when it comes to us respected listeners, my dear mothers and sisters, my dear fathers and brothers, no matter what suffering we are going through, if we think to ourselves that, okay, we are going through this difficult period, but what is our relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Is he happy with us or is he upset with us? If he is happy with us, then alhamdulillah, there's nothing that should actually sadden us. Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam here is jailed beyond his desires, beyond his wish. Obviously, he was forced into this predicament. He's totally innocent. Obviously, one will say that, but he said that jail is entering the prison is more beloved to me. He said it because he was left with no choice. I mean, he was either given the option of disobeying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and earning the displeasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And really, if one earns the displeasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that is something that should actually make us depressed. So he said, listen, I'd rather go into the prison, no matter how difficult the circumstance is, but my relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is intact. So when we feel this intense sadness, we should think to ourselves, you know, just as Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam did, what is my relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? If Allah is happy with me, then there's no reason for me to actually be sad. Obviously, seeking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's assistance with his most beautiful names, as we mentioned in the hadith by Ibn Abbas in the Sahihain, using the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, where Allah says Al-Qayyum, Al-Hayyum, meaning the everlasting, the eternal. So we should seek Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's help using his most beautiful attributes. And then, as a means of helping us also in the avenue of depression and sadness, we should affirm our hope in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, like Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam. Always have good hopes in regards to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Whatever Allah does, he does good. Never ever lose hope in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So thus we are saying, put your trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala the way you should trust him. Put total trust that whatever he does good. And this is a test that I'm going through. And as long as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is testing me, it means that he loves me. I need to be strong. I am a believer. I'm from amongst those who have accepted the prophecy of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Also to help us is also, or we should always constantly seek the forgiveness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We should seek repentance from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the main point, subhanallah, which has just come to mind, that can help us come out or help us deal with the anxieties and depressions that we might be going through is salah. And not just any salah. Some people say, you know, we read salah and it's just not helping. True salah, that when you stand in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you try and reach a level that you know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is seeing you. And you know that your life is in the hands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And you worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in such a way that you are happy with Allah and Allah is happy with you. True salah, because salah puts an end to all that which is immoral and all that which is disliked by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Inna salata tanha anil fahsha'i wal munkar. So salah is also one of the strongest remedies in putting an end to one suffering from depression. Once again, we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to protect our Muslim ummah from the aspect and avenue of anxiety and depression. Ameen. Now, respected listeners, we do have other questions. Unfortunately, we are pressed for time, so I have to always choose the questions that are related to the topic. Obviously, some aren't related to the topic, but we answer them because they are of importance and they might have a red flag next to them, meaning they're urgent and they need to be answered. So I apologize if I did or I have left out questions, but it's not the end of everything. Obviously, you do know my contact details. Feel free to contact me or phone in the station as you have been doing and putting your questions through. Obviously, you can phone straight after the program as some people have been doing. If not, you can get me on my mobile. Moving on with the tafsir, we spoke yesterday of Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam in the prison. And his actions and the way he conducted himself is an ocean, a school for all those who are in the avenues of inviting towards good and preventing from evil, for all those who are principals of their schools, for all those who are parents over their children, all those who are in a post of responsibility. Now, Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam obviously is in the prison, jailed oppressively. He has every reason to sit and sulk, but he conducts himself appropriately. How do we know that he's conducting himself appropriately? Because the two young men in the prison who saw the dreams, remember, just as a recap, one saw himself pouring wine and the other one saw himself with bread on top of his head, and the birds were pecking the bread from on top of his head. So they had this dream, they needed someone to teach them about it. They looked at Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam. Obviously he was conducting himself appropriately. He was from amongst those who were contributors to the environment that he was in. So they thought, look, this is a person we can speak to, let us go and ask him. And they did say that we see you from amongst the good doers, so please assist us in this dream. So that's the first aspect. The second aspect is that doing da'wah with one's character. If Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam didn't accept the decree of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala upon him, and he went into depression, and we were discussing depression just now, and he was sulking in the prison and didn't portray himself appropriately, then they wouldn't have approached him. And this teaches us the aspect of having good character, of being from amongst the shining stars when it comes to us dealing with people. We speak properly and appropriately, we handle ourselves conducively, properly, you know, as a Muslim should. And we did say yesterday that today we live in a day and age where doing da'wah through speaking etc. could be difficult. So what better way to do it through one's character, through one's character in himself, in his dealings with his family, in his dealings in his business. We said that Islam went to East Asia how? Through good trade practices. And we spoke yesterday about how today our business people lie in their businesses. And I did receive complaining yesterday when I mentioned the aspect of somebody lying about their cost price when they are trying to make a sale, and how Islam has warned us against this evil aspect of lying. And people say that how can we actually convince the buyer to buy if we don't lie about our cost price? A'udhu billah. We need to fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This again is the aspect of one putting his trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If a rand or a dollar or a pound is meant to come to you, nobody can take it away from you. And whatever is not meant to come from to you, no one can make it come to you. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is in total control. So we shouldn't feel that we are earning, it's our practices, it's our methodology etc. that is making us earn. We need to fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, conduct ourselves appropriately as servants of Allah and not as servants of our desires. So he showed good character. Then another aspect, he didn't tell them the dream straight away. He didn't interpret the dreams for them. What does this teach us? This teaches us that he knew that they wanted something from him, but he wanted to teach them something that they needed to know. They may have not known that they needed this information, but he knew that they needed it. More important than them actually understanding their dreams was them actually knowing the aspect of tawheed and belief in the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So even though they didn't come asking Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam the question of tawheed, he knew that they needed to know it. And it's just like when those who were at sea came to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam and asked him about the water of the seas. And they were asking him in regards to the water and its purity, etc. He told them that the water is pure for you, al-hillu maytatuhu, and its fish is halal for you. Now, I don't want to discuss the hadith in detail so as not to cause confusion. But the reason why I'm mentioning this aspect of this hadith is they came to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam asking, can we use the seawater for our purposes, for usage? Because obviously the water we have with us is for drinking, and if we use that water, we won't have water to drink. So they're asking Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam something. He answered them what they wanted to know, and then he told them something else which they needed to know. So this is from the wisdom of an alim, of a learned person, of a principal of a school, of a father in the home. He has wisdom in dealing with those around him. So even though you may be, your son might be asking you, or the student might be asking something, you will teach him that which he's asking you and that which you know he needs to know. So we learn this from the practice of Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam. Then we also learn that he didn't interpret the dreams for them immediately. He waited a while. He says, listen, before the next meal comes, I will interpret the dream for you. I won't tell it to you now. Why? Because if he interpreted the dream for them, that was it. They would have taken it and they would have gone. they wouldn't have stuck by him and waited with him, and he wanted to tell them that which they needed to know. He wanted to tell them about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He wanted to teach them about Tawheed. So he kept them in suspense, that look, wait a little while, I understand, abshir, meaning be content, I know what you guys want, I will tell you what you want to know, but not now, before your food comes. And then he bought time for himself, and this is wisdom, subhanallah. He bought time for himself and then dealt with them appropriately. So what did he call them to? He called them to Tawheed. Now remember, yesterday we mentioned that he was already calling them to Tawheed when they came and said, Inna naraka min al-muhsineen, we see you from amongst the good doers. And then he told them that, listen, I will not tell you the interpretation now, I'll tell you a bit later. After that, what did he say? He said, ذَلِكُمَا مِمَّا عَلَّمَنِي رَبِّي إِنِّي تَرَكْتُ مِلَّةَ قَوْمِ اللَّهِ يُؤْمِنُونَ بِاللَّهِ وَهُمْ بِالْآخِرَةِ هُمْ كَافِرُونَ. He said, that is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has taught me. And indeed, I have left the religion of those who do not believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and those who do not believe in the Akhirah. Subhanallah. So immediately he's teaching to them what? Tawheed. How do we know this? Because if he says, Inni taraktu millata qawmin la yu'minuna billah. Inni taraktu millata. He's saying, I've left the way of those people who don't believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If he says that, what is he saying? He's saying that I believe in Allah. By him saying, I have left the way of those who don't believe in Allah, he is telling them that I believe in Allah. Then he said, وَهُمْ بِالْآخِرَةِ كَافِرُونَ, I have left the way of those who don't believe in the hereafter. He is telling them that I believe in the hereafter. Then after that he says, وَاتَّبَعْتُ مِلَّةَ آبَائِي إِبْرَاهِيمَ وَإِسْحَاقَ وَيَعْقُوبَ ما كان لنا أن نشرك بالله من شيء ذلك من فضل الله علينا وعلى الناس ولكن أكثر الناس لا يشكرون. Beautiful words, apt words. سبحان ربي الأعلى. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is perfect. He tells them that I have followed the religion of my forefathers, Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam and Ishaq alayhi salatu wasalam and my father Yaqub alayhi salatu wasalam. It was not for us to associate anything with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Subhanallah. Then he says, that is the favor from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala upon us and upon the people. But most people know not. وَلَكِنَّ أَكْثَرَ النَّاسِ لَا يَشْكُرُونَ. And it's true, respected elders and brothers today, how many of us, my dear mothers and sisters, how many of us actually value the fact that we are Muslims, that we are from the followers of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Yusuf alayhi salam telling them, وَلَكِنَّ أَكْثَرَ النَّاسِ لَا يَشْكُرُونَ. But most people are not thankful of the aspect that Allah has chosen them to be from amongst the followers of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, from amongst the ummah that is the best of all nations. Today, for one moment, if you take a second to even imagine, if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala didn't choose you to be from amongst the Muslims, who would actually come to you and give you the da'wah towards guidance, seeing the condition of the Muslims today? So we need to thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that first and foremost we are Muslims. So the statement here, وَلَكِنَّ أَكْثَرَ النَّاسِ لَا يَشْكُرُونَ, is something for us to ponder over, to actually sit and see. As I said, everything that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, there's a lesson for us. Allah says, وَلَكِنَّ أَكْثَرَ النَّاسِ لَا يَشْكُرُونَ, most of the people are not thankful. So how many of us actually value the guidance of Islam? And if we are Muslims today, and on top of that Allah guides us, He makes us mustaqeem from amongst those who are practicing, we have to thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala even more. Why? Because today we have Muslims, but Muslims who have gone astray. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us. So Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam is teaching them the fundamentals of Tawheed. And we learn this in the beautiful revelation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In a few ayats, the way they have been put together, we take all these lessons. So he says that it wasn't our way to associate partners with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's not our way to actually associate partners. We believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as one. There is no one worthy of worship except one Allah, Rabbul Izzati wal Jalal. This is the favor of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala upon us. But most people are not thankful. So he taught them the belief in one Allah, and he taught them to believe in the Akhirah. And by him saying, وَاتَّبَعْتُ مِلَّةَ آبَائِ إِبْرَاهِيمَ وَإِسْحَاقَ وَيَعْقُوبَ, what is he telling them? He's telling them that I believe in the prophets of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Subhanallah. That's what he's saying. He's saying that I believe in the prophets of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and in their message. So he's giving the da'wah to them. Now, something for the fathers and mothers to understand here. Look how Yaqub alayhi salatu wasalam is the hero of Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam. Yaqub is his father. And look how Yaqub alayhi salatu wasalam is the hero of Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam. No matter what tests and trials and tribulations he's gone through, no matter the situation that he's in, he's speaking to these people, teaching them the teachings of his father to him. His father is his hero. Today, my dear fathers, how many of you are heroes to your children? And this is a reality. Today, when you ask the children who are your heroes, they'll start mentioning to you the different football players, the different Hollywood actors, the different Bollywood actors, and all those people out there in politics, etc., who are their heroes. Because why? As a father, maybe you lacked teaching this child of yours. So he is better off teaching the teachings of these misguided people rather than your teachings. And as I said, your child's mind is like a glass of water. When the glass of water is full, we say it's full, it's filled up with water. But when we empty this glass, we say that it's filled up with air. We never say the glass is empty. It's either it's filled up with water or it's filled up with air. And we said your child's mind is just like that. If you don't fill up your child's mind, my dear father, my dear mother, then the television is going to do the filling for you, and his friends outside the home will do the filling for you. And those people and the television will become his teachers. And the day you decide to guide him, he will be totally misguided because he won't recognize you as a teacher. And then when he speaks out there to people, he won't be saying, my father taught me this and my father taught me that. He'll be speaking about other people, subhanAllah. And we see today how much the youth actually try to emulate these personalities. So as a father, as a mother, make sure that you are the hero of your child. Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam proudly says, I am on the way of my father. I am on the way of my father. Subhanallah. So this is a lesson that we need to give cognizance to and recognize, respected elders and brothers, the aspect of parents actually being the heroes of their own children. We shouldn't make sure that we give them everything that the dunya has to offer, and when it comes to the akhirah, we have left them totally ignorant, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us in the Quran. So Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam continues giving the message. So what does he say? He says, Ya sahiba ya sijin, continuing with the story. And look at the way he addresses them. This again is a lesson. I told you today is a day full of lessons. I mean, I've left out so many lessons, but I still have so much that we can pull out just from reading the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The way Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam addresses these two people, a unique way when inviting towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He's innocent, he's not really a prisoner, but he addresses them as, O companions of the prison. He addresses them as they are his colleagues. Why? By using this methodology, the wisdom in it is to bring them closer to him. He's referring to them as inmates of the prison, my two companions of the prison. By him merely using these words, he is being wise and he's drawing these two people into him. That listen, you are my colleagues, you are two inmates over here, we are together, listen to what I have to say. So what happens automatically? And those who study knowledge in regards to psychology and these aspects, how a child's mind works, etc., we learn how important it is to use the correct words when addressing somebody. As I said, saying please, saying thank you, saying may I, saying ma'am, saying sir, as we have in the English language. So these kind of ways when it comes to dealing with people has an effect. And this again is a lesson to those who actually do the da'wah and invite towards good and prevent from evil. Choosing your words appropriately, choosing the words that actually make the person who's listening lend you his or her ear. So he says, Ya sahiba ya sijin. أرباب متفرقون خير. سبحان الله. Another aspect when it comes to teaching. Those specializing in the fields of education and psychology tell you that there's different ways that you would reach out to your students and different ways that you would reach out. Those who are lecturing, obviously, they'll tell you there's different ways that you'd reach out to those that you are lecturing. And we also learn this from the way Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam actually dealt with the Sahaba radiallahu anhum ajma'in, whereby he would teach them sometimes by lecturing them, or sometimes in a discussion, or sometimes in asking them a question and asking them to reply to it, or asking them a question which would actually make their mind think. Look at Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam, to keep them you know, in suspense, to keep their mind working, trying to keep them interested in him. He's drawing them into him. He says, أَرْبَابُ. He's asking them a question. أَرْبَابُ مُتَفَرِّقُونَ خَيْرٌ أَمِ اللَّهُ الْوَاحِدُ الْقَهَّارُ. That, oh, my two companions of the prison, are separate lords better, meaning having so many different lords, so many different idols that you worship, better than having one Allah who is one and who is Al-Qahhar, meaning the all-prevailing? He's putting a question to them, that which is better, to worship more than one Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or worshipping one Allah Rabbul Izzati wal Jalal? You are currently engaged in worshipping so many idols. Which is better? Engaging in polytheism, meaning worshipping more than one Allah, or actually worshipping one Allah Rabbul Izzati wal Jalal, who is Wahid, who is one, Al-Qahhar, the all-prevailing? So he puts this question to them, and then he says, ما تعبدون من دونه إلا أسماء سميتموها أنتم وآباؤكم ما أنزل الله بها من سلطان. He says, you don't worship anything besides mere names that you and your fathers have named, or your fathers before you have named. سميتها أنتم, you, وآباؤكم, and your fathers. ما أنزل الله بها من سلطان, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has not even taught us about or told us about. This is something from yourselves. What you guys are doing has no basis in religion. You have come up with something which is taught to you from your forefathers who are misguided. So what you are worshipping is mere names. He's putting the message across to them. Now obviously this is a strong message. If you put it across in normal circumstances, you'll get backlash. People will respond to you. But he's using an appropriate approach. He drew them in. Ya sahibi as-sijin. Oh companions, oh my inmates, oh those who are with me here. Then he questions them, makes them think. He doesn't tell them this is right and this is wrong. He says, think about it. أَرْبَابُ مُتَفَرِّقُونَ. Are different lords better, or is one Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala better? Think about it. And then he explains to them that you people are not worshipping anything except mere names that your fathers have named and you have named, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has taught us nothing about this behavior and this aspect when it comes to worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then he says, إِنِ الْحُكْمُ إِلَّا لِلَّهِ, that إِنِ الْحُكْمُ إِلَّا لِلَّهِ, he has commanded that you worship none except him. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the only one who commands and or command somebody to do something and not to do something. All aspects of worship is only for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. أَمَرَ أَلَّا تَعْبُدُ إِلَّا إِيَّا سُبْحَانَ رَبِّيَ الْأَعْلَى. What beautiful words. He says that I have been commanded that I worship nobody except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So first he says legislation is not but for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He is the one who says do, and he is the one who says don't. He is the one who legislates everything. There is nothing for us to come, meaning there's nothing for us to actually come with by ourselves or from our parents. We only do what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said we should do, and we don't do what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said we shouldn't do. Then he says that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has commanded that you worship none except him, and then he says, ذَلِكَ الدِّينُ الْقَيِّمُ, that is the correct religion. وَلَكِنَّ أَكْثَرَ النَّاسِ لَا يَعْلَمُونَ. Remember the first time he said that most people do not think. We don't realize the guidance that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us. Now he's telling them appropriately that listen, this is the reality of the situation. وَلَكِنَّ أَكْثَرَ النَّاسِ لَا يَعْلَمُونَ. But most people know not. Now there's so many lessons for us over here, and we'll stop and go through the lessons that this one ayah can teach us step by step. If we carefully analyze these ayat, my dear listeners, we see Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam actually teaching three aspects of Tawheed. The ulama have divided Tawheed into three categories to make us understand it better. And the Quran in this one ayah shows Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam inviting to all three aspects of Tawheed. He teaches Tawheed al-Rububiyyah, which is Tawheed and the belief in the lordship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then he taught them Tawheed al-Uluhiyyah, which is Tawheed and belief in the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then he taught them Tawheed al-Asma wa Sifat, meaning Tawheed and belief in the names and attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In one ayah he's done all this. How? He said arbab, meaning your Rabb. And that is teaching what? Tawheed al-Rububiyyah. Then he said amara alla ta'budu illa iyyah. So what is he teaching them by telling them this? That I have not been commanded except that I worship one Allah. He's teaching them Tawheed al-Uluhiyya. Then he said, Wahid al-Qahhar. Subhana Rabbi al-A'la. He's teaching them here Tawheed, Asma' wa Sifat, because the qualities of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is that He is Wahid and He is Al-Qahhar. He is ever prevailing and ever permanent, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now, obviously, just as a short lesson, the idolaters and the mushrikun, they believed in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's not as if they didn't believe in Allah Rabbul Izzati wal Jalal. They actually believed in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. However, they believed in other gods as well. Now, proof of this is in the Quran. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلَئِن سَأَلْتَهُمْ, that if you ask them, مَنْ خَلَقَ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ, who created the heavens and the earth, they will say that Allah created it. So this is proof to us that they believed in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And even when they are out at sea and the ship that they are in is going through a severe time, meaning there's a lot of waves or there's rain, or they are in a situation of difficulty, who do they turn to? They turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is proof that they believed in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. However, they didn't believe in uluhiyya, the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So they acknowledged rububiyya, that Allah is the creator, the nourisher, the sustainer. However, they also believed that we need these other idols to take us closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to intercede for us with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So they denied uluhiyya. And obviously tawheed al-uluhiyya is the most important aspect of tawheed, that you believe that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is one. There is no one worthy of worship except Him. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is wahid, wahidul wahid. He is one. There is no one worthy of worship except Allah. La ma'buda bihaqqin illa Allah. There is no one worthy of worship except one Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So here in this one ayah, we see Yusuf alayhi salatu wassalam actually portraying and teaching the two inmates of the prison the three aspects of tawheed. Ar-rububiyya, when he said arbab. Al-uluhiyya, the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when he said amara alla ta'budu illa iyya, I have been commanded not to worship anybody except one Allah. And then we see him teaching them the tawheed of the names and attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when he said wahidul qahhar, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is one and the ever permanent. Now, we have mentioned the importance of inviting towards one Allah, and it being the primary aspect to invite to. Again, we learn from this. Look at the first thing Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam is inviting to. I said it yesterday, that first you invite towards Tawheed. This is what all the Prophet Anbiya alayhi salatu wasalam first invited to. The first thing you invite to when going out in the field of da'wah is towards the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we also learn this from the hadith which springs to mind, which is authentic, the hadith of Mu'adh ibn Jabal, when Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam sent him to Yemen. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, إِنَّكَ سَتَأْتِي قَوْمْ أَهْلَ كِتَابٍ فَإِذَا جِئْتَهُمْ فَادْعُوهُمْ أَنْ يَشْهَدُوا أَنْ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهُ وَأَنَّ مُحَمَّدَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ. That they will come to you, the people of the book, from the Jews and the Christians. When they come to you, don't invite them to anything except that there is no one worthy of worship except one Allah, and that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is the final messenger. Only invite them to that. Don't invite them to salah, don't invite them to zakah, don't invite them to fasting, to hajj. Invite them first to tawheed. And this is what Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam did here. He didn't tell them anything else. They came to him for dreams. He told them that which they needed to know, and he first invited to the main point, which is tawheed, the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told Mu'adh, فَإِنْهُمْ أَطَاعُوا لَكَ بِذَلِكَ, that only if they accept your message that Allah is one and Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is the last prophet, only after that, فَخْبِرْهُمْ أَنَّ اللَّهَ قَدْ فَرَضَ عَلَيْهِمْ خَمْسَ صَلَوَاتٍ فِي كُلِّ يَوْمٍ وَلَيْلَةٍ. Then after that, tell them that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made compulsory upon them the rendering of the salawat 5 times a day. But don't tell them about zakat, don't tell them about fasting, don't tell them about hajj. Only tell them about salah after they've accepted tawheed. Then tell them about salah. If they accept salah, فَإِنْهُمْ أَطَاعُوا لَكَ بِذَٰلِكَ فَاخْبِرْهُمْ أَنَّ اللَّهَ قَدْ فَرَضَ عَلَيْهِمْ صَدَقَةً. And the hadith carries on, that tell them that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has commanded you to take a portion of your wealth and pass it on to the poor, etc. So the hadith goes in stages, teaching us التَدَرُّج فِي الدَّعْوَةِ, meaning doing da'wah in stages. Doing it in stages. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wanted to abolish the aspect of alcohol, He didn't just take it away immediately. He did it in stages.
And in the Quran we see it, whereby first Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, يَسْأَلُونَكَ عَنِ الْخَمْرِ وَالْمَيْسِرِ. They ask you about alcohol and gambling. قُلْ فِيهِمَا إِثْمٌ كَبِيرٌ وَمَنَافِعُ لِلنَّاسِ. Tell them that there is a great sin in doing it, in drinking alcohol and gambling. وَمَنَافِعُ لِلنَّاسِ. But in it also there is benefit. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala left it like that. And they, oh sorry, after that he said, وَإِثْمُهُمَا أَكْبَرَ مِن نَفْعِهِمَا. After that he said, but tell them that the sin in doing it is more than the benefit that you might gain from it. And Allah left it at that. After a while, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu idha qumtum ila salat, the ayah where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying that la taqrabu salata wa antum sukara, that don't come near to salah or to the masjids when you are in a state or when you are drunk or not in a state where your senses are totally with you. So now, there are five times daily salah. So, the aspect of them drinking or the regularity of them drinking decreases. So slowly now, because they have to read salah five times a day, the time that they would use in consuming alcohol is decreased. So slowly now they are coming off the aspect of alcohol. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala abolishes it totally at the end, where he says, innamal khamru wal maisiru wal ansabu wal azlam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that all the aspects of gambling and alcohol etc. are from the qualities of shaytan. Fajtanibu, stay away from it. And we learn from authentic narration that when this ayah was revealed, immediately the Sahaba radiallahu anhum ajma'in came out pouring the alcohol out in the streets, and a stream of alcohol was flowing. And years after that, when the rain used to fall in Medina, the scent of the alcohol used to come out of the ground. So when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded it, immediately they stayed away from it. And this again, since we're discussing the aspect of how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala abolished alcohol, is a lesson for us. Firstly, at-tadarruj fi da'wah, taking everything a step by step. Don't, you know, Rome wasn't built in a day. You can't make somebody mustaqim overnight. You can't make someone a practicing Muslim overnight. And you can't take someone from disbelief to Islam overnight. It has to be done in stages, with a lot of patience, with a lot of da'wah, with hikmah, as Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam teaches us, with wisdom, and also by prioritizing that which we invite people to, and making tawheed the first aspect that we invite people to. We also learn from what the Sahaba radiallahu anhum ajma'in did when they poured the alcohol out as soon as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made it haram. We learn from that the aspect of surrendering, meaning giving yourself, submitting to the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَمَا كَانَ لِمُؤْمِنٍ وَلَا مُؤْمِنَةٍ إِذَا قَضَ اللَّهُ أَمْرًا أَن يَكُونَ لَهُمُ الْخِيَرَةُ مِنْ أَمْرِهِمْ. That when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala or His Rasul declare something upon you, or teach something to you, or make something halal or make something haram, that the believers feel that they have a choice in it. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says do, and you feel you have a choice, I don't have to. And if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says don't do, you feel I have a choice, I still can. That is not the quality of a believer. وَمَا كَانَ لِمُؤْمِنٍ, a believing man, وَلَا مُؤْمِنَةٍ, or a believing woman, إِذَا قَضَ اللَّهُ أَمْرًا, if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you know, meaning decrees something, قَضَ اللَّهُ أَمْرًا, look at the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if He decrees and declares something, that a believer should feel they have a choice in it. We are again the slaves of one Allah. Whatever He said do, we do. Whatever He told us to stay away from, we stay away from. Because we are the servants of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and not of our desires. We also learn from the aspect of Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam here doing his da'wah. We learn the importance of being short and to the point. خير الكلام ما قل ودل. This is a saying that the best of speeches is that which is short and to the point. Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam didn't waste time speaking about this, speaking about that, telling them that, you know, how much difficulties I've been through, this is what my brothers did to me, this is what happened to me, I was transported out of Egypt, of Palestine, now I found myself in Egypt, I had problems in the home of the minister. He didn't start speaking about a whole lot of things. He was short and to the point. He knew he had a certain amount of time. He bought that time, remember, with exquisite wisdom that he used when speaking to them first, where he said, I'll tell you what you want to know before the meal comes. So he bought himself time, and he used that time appropriately. He took maximum out of the time that he had. He was straight and to the point. Also, we learn that it is not from the practice of a da'i, from the one who teaches, even from a teacher or a father, to attack. You don't ever solve something by attacking it. Look how Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam put a question through to them. He gave them an opportunity to think for themselves, to use the brain which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave them. And this is important. And we learn this in the concepts of nurturing, how we should deal with our children, or how a teacher should deal with his or her students, and also as a da'i should deal the person who invites towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was the person who invites towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala should deal with those who he is speaking to, and those who he is inviting towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that he doesn't attack them. We are not no one should feel offended, because the moment you start attacking people, respected mothers and sisters, my dear elders and brothers, the moment you start using this methodology of attacking and being straight to the point, obviously in certain circumstances, to be candid is from being wise. There are certain circumstances which require you to be candid and straightforward. But by attacking, most of the time, you switch off the people listening to you. So the message that you want to put across to them, they'll never listen to you. Why? Because their minds are closed. So there are many ways in inviting towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as the Sharia teaches us. And we also learn this from Surah Nuh, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions to us how Nuh alayhi salatu wasalam was inviting his people towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. قَالَ رَبِّ إِنِّي دَعُوتُ قَوْمِي لَيْلًا وَنَهَارًا. That, Ya Allah, I invited my people day and night. He's telling Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala what he did. He didn't just invite them during the day or just invite them during the night. He said, I invited them day and night. Then he says, ثُمَّ إِنِّي دَعُوتُهُمْ جِهَارًا. I invited them openly. So he's telling Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that I may have been inviting them to you in secretly or in secrecy, but I also invited them to you openly. ثُمَّ إِنِّي أَعْلَنْتُ لَهُمْ وَأَسْرَرْتُ لَهُمْ إِسْرَارًا. And then he's telling Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that I spoke to them loudly. I put the call across loudly. وَأَسْرَرْتُ لَهُمْ إِسْرَارًا. And I also spoke to them secretly, and I put the message across quietly. So many different ways in doing da'wah, so many different ways in dealing with your children, so many different ways that those who are in the secular industry and dealing with children, and even in the madrasas, etc., can use to get through to their students. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us the understanding. So many lessons from Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam. Then Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam talks to them again, and he says, once again addressing them as his inmates, Ya Sahiba Yasijin, Amma Ahadukuma. He says, O companions of the prison, as for one of you, you will give drink to his master of wine. You will pour wine, or you will, from here, the dream of yours here implies that you will be removed from the prison, and you will have a job responsibility of pouring wine for your master. But as for the other, وَأَمَّا الْآخَرِ, and now he's talking to the second person, the person who saw the birds actually eating bread from on top of his head, he said, as for you, you will be crucified, and the birds will eat from your head. Then what does he say? قُضِيَ الْأَمْرُ الَّذِي فِيهِ تَسْتَفْتِيَانِ. Subhanallah. Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam, with total wisdom, narrates the dreams to these two people. He interprets it for them. And just before they can change their story and say, you know what, no, we didn't see the dream or we saw something else, he tells them immediately, قُضِيَ الْأَمْرُ الَّذِي فِيهِ تَسْتَفْتِيَانِ. That before you decide to change anything, before you decide to change your stories or tell me that this happened and this didn't happen, I am informing you that the matter has been decreed and there's no turning away from it. Then, وَقَالَ الَّذِي ظَنَّ أَنَّهُ نَاجٍ مِّنْهُمَا اذكرني عند ربك. Then Yusuf alayhi salatu wassalam tells the person who obviously from the interpretation of the dream thought would actually get out of the prison, that's the one who was going to be a wine pourer for the king, he tells him that, listen, remember me to your Rabb, meaning Rabbik, meaning the king, or meaning your master, remember me to him, tell him about me. So Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam here, and just before speaking about that, I wanted just to mention that, did these people actually accept Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam's message? Remember, he's teaching them about Tawheed. Did they accept the message of Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala didn't tell us whether they did or they didn't. But what does this teach us? This teaches us that our job is only to portray the message, to give out the message. Guidance is in the hands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It is not our job or responsibility to guide people. As they always say, you can take the horse to the water, but you can't force the horse to drink. So you can only guide somebody, but you can't force them to follow your guidance. Everybody thinks independently, they have their own mind that they think with, and as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِنَّكَ لَن تَهْدِي مَنْ أَحْبَبْتْ وَلَكِنَّ اللَّهَ يَهْدِي مَنْ يَشَاءُ. That you do not guide who you want, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guides who He wants. So that's a point that we learn from the activity of Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam. He didn't go out there forcing them, squeezing them to accept his message. He put the message across. Whether they listen or didn't listen, that is in the hands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guides who he wills. So Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam here tells the one who he thought would actually get out of the prison and carry on with his new job description or job responsibility. He was going to work in the palace, being a wine pourer for the king. He tells him, listen, remember me to your master. Tell him about me. Then what happens? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, regarding Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam and the aspect of these two people coming out of the prison, that shaytan made the person forget to remember Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam. فَأَنْسَاهُ الشَّيْطَانُ ذِكْرَ رَبِّهِ فَلَبِثَ فِي السِّجْنِ بِضْعِ سِنِينَ. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that shaytan made this person forget to remember Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam, or to tell his master of Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam. فَلَبِثَ فِي السِّجْنِ بِضْعِ سِنِينَ. And thus he remained in the prison for several years. فَأَنْسَاهُ الشَّيْطَانُ ذِكْرَ رَبِّهِ فَلَبِثَ فِي السِّجْنِ بِضْعَ سِنِينَ. So Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam, and there's a lot of lessons that we can take again from this ayah. I think we are pressed for time. I don't know how much time we have left. I think it's about 3 minutes or so. So I won't start deriving the lessons that we do learn from this ayah today. Inshallah, we'll do that tomorrow. But just to put the story into perspective, Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam was in the prison. As we heard from yesterday, he was jailed beyond his wish, and then he was faced with these two people who saw the dreams, and they saw good in Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam. They seen him as a knowledgeable person. They said, we can get him to help us with these dreams. He interpreted the dreams for them. He bought some time from them, and in the process invited them towards the aspect of Tawheed, the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then he interpreted to them their dream. And after that, he said to the one who he knew would go free. Dhanna in the Arabic language, I just want to mention a point. Because I did say that he said to the one who he thought actually would be saved. In the Arabic language, dhanna, and in the Quran, sometimes means thought, and sometimes means yaqeen, means he knew. And the most correct interpretation would be here, that he knew. And this is for those who study the Arabic language, they actually come across this. Those who study the Arabic language and study usul al-fiqh, meaning the principles of fiqh, the principles that are used in deriving laws from the sharia, you would learn this. So dhanna in the Arabic language sometimes implies thinking or thought, and sometimes implies yaqeen, meaning something which is definite and apparent. So Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam said to the one that he knew would go free, mention me before your master, remind me about him. But shaitan made this person forget to do what Yusuf alayhi salam requested him to, and thus Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam remained in the prison for several years. There's a lot of lessons that we can derive from this. Our time has come to an end. Everything that I've said in this tafsir which is correct is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If I've made any mistake, it's from myself and shaitan, and I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala his forgiveness. Join me again tomorrow. Wa sallallahu wa sallam wa baraka ala nabiyyina Muhammad.